Everybody. On behalf of everyone at the PMI Victorian History Library, I would like to welcome you all today. My name is Lauren and I'm the Chief Librarian. We acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which we gather. Our library is located on the lands of the Wurundjeri Woi-wurrung people of the Kulin Nation, and we pay our respects to elders past and present. Sovereignty has never been ceded. It always was, it always will be Aboriginal land. Firstly, I'd like to just quickly point out the facilities. The bathroom is located through the main doors at the back there and just round the corner. We have an emergency exit outside the doors to my right and down to the end of the corridor, and another out the main doors behind you. In the unlikely event of an emergency, a staff member will direct you out of the building. The PMI Victorian History Library is the second oldest library in Victoria, founded in 1854. We have more than 40,000 items on site, and we are the only library in Australia with such a large, loanable reference collection. Our core collection is local history, and we hold information on most towns in Victoria. I'd like to welcome Simon, 3AW station historian and co-host of the Sunday night program, Remember When. Having gathered insights from many of the stars who've worked at the station over its 90 plus years, he will explain how the station has evolved and answer any questions you might have about Melbourne's most listened to radio station. Over to you.
Thank you. Oh, that's good. Applause before I start. I like that because it might not be there at the end. Thank you all very much for coming today. I don't do a lot of these sort of speeches because, generally, I never really think that many people would be terribly interested. So when you get all involved in a hobby, something that fascinates you personally, you become very aware that you can bore people sideways talking about it to others. Tony Moclair and aeroplanes, Grubby Stubbs and trains, yes. Philip Brady and Nazis. They're all topics that they're very close to people's hearts. But when you myself and my Melway collection is just something that just can bore people completely sideways. So thank you all for coming. 3AW is it's always been a fairly big part of my life. It was my reason for wanting to get into radio all those years ago was basically listening to Black as an Unker on 3AW in the 1980s. Them doing Story Time and Harry and Clary and just all the segments they did. I was interested in the Radler Report, even though I had no idea who John Radler was and where this mythical country America was. You know, as a kid, it all meant nothing to me, but I loved it. I was just fascinated to listen to the radio. And so my uncle managed to get me work experience at 3DB. Because I was interested in radio. He had always said, no, don't get into radio. It's a terrible industry. It's full of backstabbing people and it's the most insecure industry. You know, you'll be riding high one day and gone the next. My uncle was Jeff Cork, who was the first man on television in Victoria and also a 3DB personality in his own right before that. And Graham Kennedy's original sidekick in Melbourne Tonight, you may all remember. So he always discouraged me from doing it, but I had the pleasure of going with him to Channel O, or Channel 10, it might have just become Channel 10. They did a Back to Variety reunion special to raise money for, I think it was a deafness telethon. And I had the pleasure of going. They had a table for Sunnyside Up, a table for In Melbourne Tonight, and all of those wonderful old shows. And Uncle Jeff, was, of course, on the In Melbourne Tonight table. And I had the pleasure of sitting there next to Philip Brady. And I was 13 years of age at the time. And Uncle Jeff turned to Philip and said, Philip, I've been telling my nephew here, he wants to get into radio, and I've been telling him what a terrible industry it is. It's awful, isn't it? You'd advise against it, wouldn't you, Phil? To which Phil said, oh, no, buddy. Oh, no, radio and television, it's my dream. I couldn't imagine my life without it. Oh, buddy, if you can get into radio or television, go right ahead and do it. And so Uncle Jeff wasn't terribly pleased, but sadly, a few years later, Uncle Jeff passed away. And at the funeral, Bert Newton gave a eulogy, which was, there was something there. I'm a little kid sitting there looking at Bert Newton standing there in front of me, talking about my uncle and the great adventures they had in television and radio together. And it really sort of sparked me. And Philip was there. And my aunt pointed out that Philip had just recently started doing nights with Bruce Mansfield on 3AW, hosting Nightline. And so I wrote to Bruce and Phil and said, would you mind terribly much if I came in and watched you? I'd love to come in and just watch the show. And Philip wrote back. I never got his reply. It was faxed to me at my job at the Commonwealth Bank, and the fax just never came through. So a week or so later, I'm thinking, oh, well, you know, I tried. I'll just leave it at that. I'm not going to bother him again. And then Philip reached out again and said, perhaps you didn't get my first message, but yes, you would be welcome to. And so I came in and I sat in on Bruce and Phil's show, and it was just a dream for me. I just adored it. And so the producer graciously allowed me to come back a couple of weeks later. And but by that stage, because I'd grown up listening to Bruce with John Blackman, they were doing what Bruce and Phil did so well. And I was saying to the producer, oh, Bruce should say this. Well, Philip should say that. You know, I think it'd be funny if Bruce said that in response to what Phil just said. And the producer, Paige McGinley, said, there's a button just there and there's a microphone. If you press that button, it goes into Bruce's headphones. So if you think he should say something, he loves being fed lines, feed him a line. So I fed Bruce a line. Bruce used it, and I just created comedy on the radio. It wasn't me delivering it, but I was responsible for something funny that Bruce said that made Phil laugh and made the producer laugh. And I was completely addicted. And to cut that long story short, when Paige McGinley moved on, they went through another couple of producers in a couple of months, and then nobody knew the show better than me. So when the producer Rowena moved on from the show, Phil and Bruce went into Steve Price, who was program director, and said, why don't you give this kid the chance to produce the show? And Price, he said, no, I don't want to have a male in there. It'll be blokey. I want another female producer in there. Otherwise, you guys get too, you know, a bit too crass. We need a female to keep you in line. And Phil said to him, give him an interview. And so Steve got me in and said, what do you want to do? And I said, well, I want to work with Bruce and Phil. And he said, oh, everyone sees that as a stepping stone. What do you really want? Is it news, sport, current affairs? And I said, no, it's Bruce and Phil. It's nighttime fun radio. That's what I love. And he said, well, good, because I'm sick of employing people, having them there for a couple of months, and then they move on to another role, and then I have to find someone else again. If you want the job, it's yours. So that's how I got my foot in the door, and 28 years later, I'm still there. So that's basically my story in short. But to get onto 3AW, 1932 was the year that 3AW first went to air. There was a meeting in late January with George Clark Allen, who was the director of Allen's Music, Jeffrey Syme, who was the managing editor of the Age newspaper, and John Henry Tate, who was from J.C. Williamson's theatrical company. And they sat down, and there was a ledger, and I actually fished this out of a bin, believe it or not, a big ledger book, and I've got the handwritten minutes of the meeting in which 3AW was actually formed. So 3AW got its letters for the call sign from those companies. Allen's and The Age is where the A comes from, and J.C. Williamson's is where the W comes from. And there's a few others. 3AK was the Akron Tire Company. 3DB, the Drewley Business College. 3LO came from London. 3KZ and 3UZ were just made up ones. There was nothing actually to them. And later on, when 3MP started, MP for Mornington Peninsula. So that's where most of those stations got their names from. So 3AW launched on February the 22nd at 8 p.m. They had Vernon Sellers, Ed E. Ford, who was a popular performer at the Tivoli, Pietro, John Warren, and the 3AW Male Quartet. And following the official launch at 8 o'clock, they had J.C. Williamson's Imperial Grand Opera were performing with an appearance by Jack O'Hagan. Who's heard the name Jack O'Hagan before? Along the Road to Gundagai, our Don Bradman. He was quite an important figure at 3AW in those early years because he also wrote advertising jingles. He could sing, perform, he hosted. He was sort of jack of all trades there. So it's good to know that Jack O'Hagan was there on the very first night that 3AW broadcast. Our first breakfast host was a guy named Vernon Sellers. And I really don't know much about him, but out of the blue one day I got a phone call from a lady who said, I'm looking for information on my grandfather. And I believe he worked at 3AW. And I said, okay, well, what era are we talking? She said, oh, it'd be pretty early on in the 1930s. And I said, oh, okay, what's his name? And she said, Vernon Sellers. And I said, oh, you'll be able to tell me more than I'll be able to tell you. But he was a singer, and she very kindly sent me a copy of a song that he sang. So I've got that in my little archive, in my little collection. But Vernon was only the breakfast host for a couple of months. Taking over from him was Nicky and Tuppy. Now, everyone would have heard those names, I'm sure. Cliff Nichols Witter and Fred Tupper. Nicky, of course, would later go on to work at 3UZ and discover Graham Kennedy and launch, you know, probably the most important television career that has existed so far in Australia. So Nicky and Tuppy did our breakfast show for 14 years. Now, Nicky was also a singer in J.C. Williamson's theatrical productions. I've only recently discovered that. I had no idea that Nicky was actually a singer. I know he did a Mother's Day record at some point. I think one of a couple of 3AW stars to do Mother's Day records and release them at some point. And Tuppy was also 3AW's chief sporting announcer. And when they started on breakfast, they also joined the afternoon kids program, which was called Chatterbox Corner in the afternoon. So has anyone heard of Chatterbox Corner before? Yeah. So Nicky and Tuppy were part of that. And then a year after that started, a lady named Kathleen Lindgren, who was a ukulele player, she walked past the studios and on impulse just, oh, here I am outside a radio station. On impulse, she walked in to inquire about work. The receptionist happened to be someone she knew, happened to be a friend. And so the receptionist, Pauline, spoke to E. Mason Wood, who was the station's manager. He auditioned her at 4 p.m. that same afternoon. And at 4:15, she was asked if she could start at 5 p.m. that day. So Kathleen's just walked in off the street, and a couple of hours later, she's actually on air with the Chatterbox Corner crew. So that's, and she actually went on to become Nicky's wife, and the two of them were happily married for many, many years. She was introduced on air as the ukulele lady, but eventually became known as Nancy Lee. So Nicky and Nancy Lee, of course, legends as they were. There was, she got the name because there was a song at the time called He Played His Ukulele as the Ship Went Down. So she sang that a number of times on the show, and the name of the ship was the Nancy Lee. So that's where the name just came from. It just sort of stuck. So there's a little bit more about Chatterbox Corner I'll tell you in a sec, because it grew phenomenally. Of course, long before television, there were clubs you could join with radio stations, the Flying Axe Handles and Chatterbox Corner and others. People would send off their money or just request a membership, and you get your little certificate. And I've had a few of them sent to me over the journey from listeners who have, their parents have sadly passed away, and they've said, oh, I found this thing with 3AW on it, do you want it? And I go, oh yes, it'll look great in the display cabinet outside the studios. So in 1935, 3AW moved from it was at His Majesty's Theatre. They moved to 382 La Trobe Street, which would be the home for the next 50-odd years. David Mann tells a story. So we're looking at 1935, and the building at 382 La Trobe Street had been a mattress factory, and there was something else, some other bits and pieces of history of that particular building. But David Mann then tells a story that just after we moved in 1990, just after we moved from 382 La Trobe Street to 43 Bank Street, a lady contacted David Mann and said, I'm sad that 3AW's moved because that was my childhood home that you were broadcasting from. And she was a lovely 80-something-year-old lady. And David said, oh, no, it wasn't a home. It was a factory. And she said, no, but before that, that was where my family lived. And David Mann had contacts with the fire brigade, and the building had been, you know, closed off and locked up, and it was, you know, unsafe for people to go into, so it was ready to be demolished. So David said to a friend of his in the fire brigade, do you mind if I take this lady inside and we'll have a look around? And so it was organised. So they've walked in to the old building, they've wandered up through the offices and things, and David said, oh, this is Claudia Wright's office here, that's where she was for quite a number of years. And she said, yes, this was my bedroom. And she said, and there was my fireplace was just behind that wall. And David said, no, maybe it's another room, there's never been a fireplace here. And she said, yes, just behind that wall. And David thought, well, they're going to knock the building down anyway. So he's walked over and he's kicked a hole in the wall and ripped all the plaster off. Sure enough, there was her fireplace. So what a lovely memory for her. I don't know why I get moved telling that story, but it's just, you know, it's lovely to think that after all those years, she was able to go back and revisit her bedroom, which was Claudia Wright's office. 3AW's big signing in 1936 was a 45-year-old movie star, best known for his stage work with Nat Phillips, who I don't think many people would remember. He was best known as Stiffy. Harry Vandersloos was his name, otherwise known as Roy Rean. And of course, Mo McCackie he had so many different names, I never quite know what to call him. But Mo McCackie was heard nightly at 7 p.m. and he was extremely popular and with the station for quite some time. 1937, John Masters joined, hosting John Masters Offers You the Public Taste. He'd go on to host a dozen or so shows at AW in his career, but he was most fondly remembered for Choice of the People. Did anyone ever listen to Choice of the People? Yes, yeah, a while ago, showing your age, yeah. Choice of the People was a request show, and it was based on an English show, but it ran for 20-odd years, from 1941, not 20 years exactly, actually, 1941 it started, finishing in 1960. 1937 was also the year of the first Carols by Candlelight, and of course Norman Banks was the man behind that. He was the brains behind it. He wasn't at 3AW at the time. He came to 3AW in 1952. He was at KZ, of course. But I love the story of how that started, with Norman Banks being drunk, walking home down St Kilda Road one night. He'd done a little Christmas shopping, apparently, and stopped in at the pub for a couple. And as he was walking home, he walked past a lady's window, and he could see through the window a lady there with just lit by one candle, and she was singing along to Christmas carols on the radio. And he thought, oh, wouldn't it be a lovely thing if we actually just got people together to sing carols in a park or somewhere? I think that would be a good idea. So he told his secretary about it, Dot Dawson, the wife of Smokey Dawson. We remember Smokey Dawson, the singing cowboy? Dot Dawson was Norman's secretary, assistant, and Dot was the one who said, oh, that's lovely, you could call it Carols by Candlelight, and that's where the name came from. So they organised it. They organised the first one, and Dot told the story beautifully of that first one and what a disaster it was, because they had this tiny little stage, and they had all these people, you know, in the choir and guests and that who were all going to appear, but the stage was way too small. So people would sort of climb up on the back of the stage to get on, and they'd sort of gently push forward, and then people would just fall off the front of the stage. So they'd run around the back to try and get back up. So over the course of the night, as everyone's trying to sing these lovely carols, people are just falling off the front of the stage all evening. It's hasn't it gone on to be just an amazing thing, Carols by Candlelight? And Norman wrote a carol called the Melbourne Carol, and every year Philip Brady tries to get a campaign up and going to have them actually sing the Melbourne Carol at Carols by Candlelight as a tribute to Norman. But of course it's a national thing now, hosted by Sydney people, so it's not likely to ever happen. 1938, Terry Deer left 3KZ to come to 3AW, hosting shows like Spelling Jackpots, The Pepsodent Show, Quiz Kids, And he'd leave in 1950 to go and host the Amateur Hour on 3DB, but he came back in late 56 and brought the Amateur Hour with him. Now, I mentioned Chatterbox Corner earlier, and you could become a member of the Chatterbox Corner Club, which was the chums. You were a chum if you joined Chatterbox Corner's club. By 1939, there were 71,000 chums in Chatterbox Corner, which is an astonishing, astonishing figure. Jack Davey was—he joined the station in 1940, not sort of directly. He was at 2GB as the breakfast announcer, but he'd started doing quiz shows, and had clearly demonstrated a great talent. Because Jack Davey and Bob Dyer, as you might all know, were just such huge names in those quiz shows and variety shows. There was no one better than the two of them, and they had a very friendly rivalry. They were actually good friends off air, but they'd dig each other and in the ribs and give each other a bit of a hard time. But Jack Davey would hit the air on 3AW in 1940 with Yes No Jackpots and Hot and Cold Jackpots. That's What You Think, and the shows would come out of Sydney live at 9:40 p.m. 1941, Jack Davey appeared before the Central Summons Court for having an unlicensed radio. Do you remember we used to have a license to watch television or listen to the radio? Well, Jack Davey never got a license, so he's had to appear in court. And in giving evidence, Inspector Bede Marley told the court that Jack Davey had told him that he seldom used the wireless and quoted him as saying, "I get enough radio, I get sick of listening to it." But Jack was still fined £3 for being in breach of listening to a radio without having a license. On Buzz went to air for the first time, hosted by Jack Davey. The cast over the 10-year life of the program was a who's who of radio talent. Willie Fennell, Roy Rean, Rex Wackador, and Queenie Ashton were some of the stars who appeared on that. I should point out, by the way, if anyone's ever got any questions, please feel free to interrupt me, because just me rabbiting on can get a bit tiring. And there'll be someone at some point will nod off, I'm sure. 1944, we started broadcasting football. It was only a very small element of it. Bill Vickers was the first person to call football for 3AW, and it was only for the finals as well. Fred Tupper was calling the races each Saturday afternoon from 1:30. The program listing was Racing with Fred Tupper and Football with Bill Vickers. Fred would call the races, then cross to Bill, who would give score updates on all the VFL matches that were in progress. But it was during the finals that Bill first gave a ball-by-ball description. 1946 was a big year, because that was the year Nicky quit. He'd been doing breakfast with Fred for all those years. He went off on holidays, and he also did a Saturday afternoon show called Junior Stars of the Air, and that was recorded in advance. So he's gone on holidays, and he's turned on the radio to tune in to hear his show, and it wasn't on. It had been dumped and another program had taken its place. So he resigned. He rang the boss and said, "Not coming back. That's it. I quit." So just like that, Nicky was gone from 3AW. Tuppy stayed on at 3AW until 1952, but by then Nicky was at 3UZ and kept saying, "Come across, come across." And so Tuppy left in 1952 to go and join Nicky at DB. UZ, sorry. Thank you. 1950, at an expense of £1,000, I do love this story with Fred Tupper. Fred was sent to England to broadcast a call of the 1950 Derby to 3AW and all affiliated stations. It was estimated that 1 million people were going to stay up and listen to that broadcast. Tuppy was thrilled, and to top it off, he also backed the winner with a substantial bet, so he made quite a bit of money. But two things went wrong. After the broadcast, which Tuppy was very proud of, a purple-faced engineer came up and said, "Not one word of your broadcast went through because we had technical problems." So Tuppy was so devastated that that had happened. He had the winnings in a bag, and he handed that bag to a colleague who promptly absconded and was never seen again. So he lost all his winnings, as well as not being able to, sadly, do that broadcast that he'd flown over there to do. His colleague absconded to Paris, I have on record as saying here. So 1952, as we mentioned, Norman Banks joined 3AW in 1952. He was he was so huge on 3KZ, and he wanted to go and broadcast from the Helsinki Olympics. And 3KZ said no. And so he said, all right, well, I quit. And 3UZ immediately jumped in and offered to send Norman to Helsinki to cover the Olympics. And he said, well, that'd be lovely, thank you. But the very same day, but later that afternoon, 3AW made an approach and said, we would love you to come on board and work at 3AW. And he said, well, I've just told 3UZ that I'd happily do the Helsinki Olympics for them. And I can't renege on that. And 3AW was very much, oh, but you haven't signed a contract. But Norman Banks was a man of his word, so he did the Olympics for 3UZ, and then he came across to 3AW. And I think it's lovely that that Norman was, you know, so responsible in that sense. You know, he had agreed to do it, so good on him for doing it. And it's one of Norman's first jobs at 3AW was to call a VFL footy match with Tony Charlton. It was in October. It was an exhibition match, and it was the first ever match of football held under lights. It was, I got here where it was. It was at a race course, either Flemington or Caulfield or somewhere, I'm not sure. But yeah, it was the first night match since 1935 on Saturday, the 11th of October, 1952. Norman was calling that match with Tony Charlton. We had the pleasure of chatting to Tony Charlton about that match and what it was like to call football for that very first time with Norman Banks. And Tony Charlton beautifully told the story that because it was a racetrack, all the lighting was around the edge of the oval. So whenever the ball got anywhere near either end, Norman would jump in and do the commentary. You know, so-and-so has kicked it to so-and-so, it's in Essendon's full forward line, and a goal has been kicked. And then when the ball goes back, over to you, Tony, and it was pitch black in the middle. So they couldn't see who had the ball, they could see very little. They could just basically see where the players were moving, in which direction. So Tony would just make up stuff that he thought might be happening in the middle of the field, and as it would come to the forward line, Norman would be, I'll take it from here, Tony, and off he would go and continue the commentary. So he was a gentleman, but he could also be a little on the crafty side. Dennis Gibbons joined in 1952. Does anyone remember Dennis Gibbons? Yes, he was probably 3AW's greatest ever prankster. And I've got a couple of loose stories that have been told to me, but probably my two favourites. One was that, I don't know who the newsreader was, but there was a newsreader doing the bulletin. He's got his microphone in front of him and he's got his scripts. And Dennis Gibbons opened the door to the news booth, threw in a handful of chicken feed all over the desk, and then threw in a chicken. So the chicken is standing on the news desk as the announcer's trying to read around the chicken, trying to do the bulletin. And the chicken's clucking and pecking. So you're getting all the noises of the chicken pecking at all the food. So I just think that's a lovely prank. The other thing that Dennis did, which I imagine would have got him in some sort of trouble, of course, all the electronic equipment used to run a radio station, especially back then in the 50s, were all very large, heavy machines. So Dennis decided to tie to the edge of a massive machine sitting in a corner. I don't know what the machine was for, but he tied a rope around one end of the machine, draped it out the window down to the car park, and tied the other end to the station manager's car. It just sort of dropped down the building through some bushes, so the manager wouldn't actually see it when he went to his car, thinking that it would just be funny, because when the manager started his car, he wouldn't be able to go anywhere because it was anchored by this big machine. Well, he misjudged how powerful the engine was in the station manager's car. So he's put the accelerator down, he's driven off, it's dragged the machine straight across the room and slammed it into the wall, at which point the rope was so tight it then ripped the bumper bar off the back of the manager's car. But great prankster, I wouldn't try it today, but you've got to love Dennis Gibbons for doing those sorts of things. By 1954, there were a lot of serials on air, like Tarzan, The Air Adventures of Hop Harrigan and Gunsmoke. Life with Dexter was also on air by then. In 1955, Jack Davey he was doing Give It a Go, and we had there's a guy named Jamie Kelly who I really admire as a historian of radio. He's a blind gentleman, and he's got he's got a room in his house, which his wife isn't thrilled about, but it's full of old records, the old acetate records. And he goes through and catalogues each one and you know, makes a note of who's on it and uploads the audio. And he came across a wonderful episode where Jack Davey, hosting Give It A Go, was that one of the contestants on the show was a young man named John Howard. And it was the schoolboy, John Howard, who would later go on to become Prime Minister John Howard. And so he let that audio out a couple of years ago and it did the rounds and John Howard was, you know, commenting on it. It was whilst he was still Prime Minister, I believe. But it was very funny because he was quite a cheeky little school kid. And he was asked a question, what sort of tree sheds its leaves? And I think the answer is a deciduous tree. Is that right, for deciduous trees, the ones that shed their leaves? And he didn't know the word, so he just said, oh, I think it's a shedding tree. And so but it's very funny to listen to. If you ever get a chance to hear it, it's well worth it. It was 10 years before Talkback at that point. Norman Banks was doing a show called I'm On Your Side, which was a sort of a predecessor to being able to take calls on air. People would write in and Norman Banks would read out their problems. And then he realised that they could actually do live calls, not legally, you can't put the calls to air. So what they would have is the microphone and Norman Banks with a handset up to his ear. And he'd be saying, hello, Mrs. Bottrell. Yes, you have a problem? I see. Yes. So tree roots are raising the footpath outside your house, yes. Well, I'd recommend, I'm on your side. I think your council needs to do more about this. I think you need to contact them and tell them that you've spoken to me and we'll be keeping an eye on things. And that's how he hosted the show, I'm On Your Side. Just taking calls off air and you would only hear his side of the conversation with him just sort of parroting everything back that the callers said. He'd often just tell people to write a stern letter to their local member of parliament. So it was an interesting idea, but 10 years before Talkback, that was the only way it could be done. 1956, TV was introduced. They spent £150,000 on renovations to 3AW to combat this threat of television. And our transmitter was boosted from 600 watts to 5,000 watts, which is the same power. Like, I don't understand technically how it all works, but it's the same power level that we're allowed to broadcast at today on AM. The ABC are allowed to broadcast at 50,000 watts. We're restricted to 5,000 watts. So when you can't hear us because there's trams and stuff nearby, just know that that's one of the reasons why we are actually restricted. Thank God we've got digital radios now for a lot of people. 1959, they established the 3AW newsroom. Miles Wright was the man behind that. I went through a bit because I'm rabbiting on far too long about some of these things. Peter James joined in the early 1960s, I think. Bill Jacobs joined Norman Banks calling football and would do so until 1988. And in 1967 was when Talkback Radio officially started. 3AW was a leader in, you know, public affairs broadcasting with Norman's I'm On Your Side. Andrea was also at the station by then. And we had service programs such as Ask the Clergy, Marriage Guidance, Ask the Doctor, Ask the Lawyer, and of course, Martha Gardner Recommends. Everyone loved Martha Gardner? Absolutely. Wasn't she wonderful? She had an answer for everything. These programs were sort of roundtable discussions and people could write to programs to ask, you know, to raise issues and give opinions. But it was 1967 when it was finally allowed that we were able to take calls, put physical phone calls to air. We had to operate in delay, of course. When the federal government finally allowed it, there was a race to be the first one to air. Now, many people claim that Mike Walsh was the first to use Talkback. It was his 9 a.m. till midday program on 2SM in Sydney. But the truth of the matter is that 2UE stole their thunder by putting calls to air with Ormsby Wilkins. Ormsby actually went in at midnight so that he would be first to take calls. So he snuck in and beat Mike to the job. In Melbourne, it was Norman Banks who first took an open line call on his show, but they again, not wanting to take any risks and making sure that everything sails smoothly, the very first talkback caller on 3AW with Norman Banks was Barbara McFarlane, who was his secretary. So there we are. So she was calling from the office, and that was the very first talkback caller that went to air. Bill Howie, do we remember Bill Howie? Yeah, he was last on 3A, he was on 3AK for many years and was last on Magic, I think. Sadly, passed away a couple of years ago. But Bill Howie once told me that he had actually put call in 1963, 4 years before they were technically allowed to do talkback, but no one knew about it. And so, and when management found out he was doing it, they made him stop. But he reckons he got away with it for a few months. So, you know, if there is ever an official debate on who was the first person to put talk back to air, it's probably Bill Howie, 4 years before it was legal. 1970, Don Taylor started a program called Nightline. He was replaced by John McIntosh and then by Alex Kenworthy for 20 years, from 1971 through to 1980, when sadly all that ended. Jim Archer was one of the staff members. We have a story about the 3AW ghost, and the 3AW ghost in the Latrobe Street building was Jim Archer. He passed away during the football. Graham Goodings, who was another staff member at the time, wrote about Jim's death. He said, his role during the football coverage wasn't all that demanding. Hosting up to the preview before the game, then crossing to the commentary team at the MCG for the description of play. After that, he'd play the Victoria Bitter commercials on a cue from the ground, and he would read the news at halftime. The operator at the MCG cued Jim to play a commercial at quarter time, but nothing happened. So the commentators continued on with their review of play so far. Back in the studio, Jim had a massive heart attack and had sadly passed away in the chair there. He wasn't found until half time when a journalist from the newsroom was delivering his scripts for the news. David Mann, Colin Tyrus, who was our news director and reporter for some time, Philip Brady and Jane Holmes all claim to have had encounters with the 3AW ghost. I won't tell you all of their stories, but Philip's story was he was doing Midnight to Dawn playing music, and he's put a record on, and he's thought, I've got 3 minutes here, I'll duck downstairs off to the loo, because the toilet in Latrobe Street was in a different building. He had to go down and out. So he went to the loo, had a cigarette, and as he was coming up the stairs, he thought, oh, the record's going to have finished, there'll be dead air going to air. And when he came up, he said the record was on part, had been flipped over, and side two was playing. And he said there was no one else in the building. So he claims it was Jim Archer looking after him. 1972 was the first time that 3AW would ever hit number one in the ratings. And it was only for one survey, and they wouldn't hit number one again until 1982. I won't go through all the station shuffles, but Ormsby Wilkins arrived there in 1972 as well. And of course, Norman Ormsby and Claudia with The Great Debate is probably one of the most memorable programs in 3AW's history. It didn't run all that many years. Claudia Wright arrived in 1974 and was fired in 1977. She was only there for 3 years, but when you talk about 3AW history and you ask for names, one of the first names that people mention is Claudia Wright. So she made a huge impact in the time she was there. And she would really, you know, stick it to Norman and Ormsby. She was no shrinking flower. She was very happy to voice her opinion. We had the pleasure of interviewing her. Sadly, she entered early stages of dementia by the time we were talking to her. But we pre-recorded an interview and just put together all sort of the lucid moments so that we could put something to air in her honour. And she passed away, sadly, not long after. Norman Banks retired in 1978. And that was sort of an important thing. Norman Banks, of course, probably along with Darren Hinch and Neil Mitchell, in terms of the current affairs commentators, they've been the big three on 3AW's history. So Norman Banks retiring actually led to Bruce Mansfield getting the job on Breakfast a few years later. Paul Barber was doing Breakfast in 1980, and he was replaced with John Blackman and Sam Lipsky. Derren was looking for a new producer at the time and hired Paul Barber. So the day that Paul Barber was sacked, the management were a bit iffy with Paul Barber, so they got rid of him and said, "We're not putting you on Breakfast anymore. It's John Blackman and Sam Lipsky. Sorry, Paul, you're off." Derren was looking for a new producer at the time because he'd just joined the station, and he was a good friend of Paul Barber's. So he said, "Do you want to be my producer?" And he said, "Yes." So Derren went into management about 10 minutes after they fired Paul Barber, and he said, "Good news, I found a producer. He's a gun, he's a great journalist, got a bit of radio history, print journalist history, he's fantastic, I'm very happy to have him." And they said, "Terrific, who is it?" "Paul Barber." "We just got rid of him." So that's Hinch in all his best. Mark Day also joined 3AW around the same time in the early 80s. So with Bruce Mansfield, John Blackman did Breakfast with Sam Lipsky for about a year, then Sam left. And most people, I have no memory of Sam Lipsky doing Breakfast with John. It must have been just before my time listening. But John was then flying solo, and he was doing a fine job. But by this stage, Brian White had become the manager of 3AW, who was a very respected program director and a journalist in his own right. And John met Bruce Mansfield on the set of Celebrity Squares. And Bruce had a great reputation of doing impersonations. He used to do them in Melbourne Tonight with Graham. And he'd impersonate Graham, he'd impersonate Bert Newton and anyone else. And he did a very good Norman Banks. So John said to him, "Since Norman's retired, and everyone's still missing Norman, it had only been 2 years since he'd left the station, why don't you ring in and we'll do a weekly segment on what's Norman Banks up to?" And it would just be Bruce making stuff up. And so they did, and it was very funny radio. And Brian heard it and thought, "I reckon there's something in this. These two guys have got good chemistry." So he said to Bruce, "Why don't you come in and do it live? But it can't be Norman Banks. You really can't just keep taking the mickey out of Norman Banks." So they just created a character called Uncle Roy. And that led to that partnership. Bruce started doing it just as a weekly spot. Then it became a daily spot with just a couple of little inserts in the show. And eventually he moved into co-hosting the entire show. And with Bruce and John in Breakfast, and with Derren Hinch in Mornings, Muriel Cooper in Afternoons, and Mark Day in Drive, and Alex Kenworthy at Night, the station hit number one. And for its second time, but this time it pretty much stayed there. There was the breakfast show, Black as an Uncle were number one, but then it would be Pete and Liz on 3KZ, Peter Meehan and Liz, what's Liz's last name? I've forgotten. Anyway, Pete and Liz on 3KZ would be number one, then Black as an Uncle. But overall, 3AW hit number one and managed to stay there pretty much for the next 6 or 7 years. That was really the time that 3AW came into its own with Ash Wednesday, and the fundraiser that 3AW put on for that was incredible. They raised millions of dollars to go to people who had been affected by the fire. It all began to fall apart for 3AW when John Blackman left to go to 3AK. Kerry Packer had bought 3AK and he owned 2UE, and he decided he was going to do networking radio. And so he'd have John Blackman in Breakfast in Melbourne. I think it was George Negus in Sydney doing Breakfast, and then Don Lane doing Mornings or something like that. And I can't remember the rest of the lineup. But of course, the problem in Melbourne is when you've got Don Lane on air going, "Hey, it's a beautiful day. I'm looking out over the harbour. There's the bridge. It's magnificent." And we're in Melbourne and it's raining. It really just didn't sort of wash. And 3AW management came up with billboards that they put up that just simply said, "If we wanted to listen to Sydney radio, we'd live in Sydney." And that 3AK experiment just never got off the ground. It only lasted a year or so.
You had Bert Newton and Graham Kennedy on 3AK too. They used to broadcast from Graham's place down in Kingston.
They did too. That is correct. Yes, yes. Was that wasn't part of that CBC thing though, was it?
It was after Packer took over, because it was Channel 9.
Oh, yes, yes. Yeah, yeah, of course. So there you go. So 3AW, so with John leaving to go to 3AK, and then Derren Hinch left to go and host Hinch at 7 on 7, That sort of left a bit of a hole in the lineup. Darren James ended up being Bruce's new co-host in Breakfast, and they still did great radio. It was all very entertaining. But the station wasn't as strong as it once was. It was just beginning to falter just a bit. And Mike Peterson in 1989 was the general manager, and he said, personality radio, which was the catchphrase for the station at the time, I think it's done its day. We're going to change format. We're going thinking person's radio. And we had a television campaign with the thinker statue, if I don't know if anyone would remember, in 1989. And they got rid of Darren and Unca. And Darren always tells a story that Mike Peterson called them into the office after a show, and it was a great show that morning. And he said, "Gentlemen, I'm sorry, we have to part company." And Darren said, "Why? Where are you going?" He said, "Not me, you." And so he sacked them, and he put Bill Tuckey into Breakfast, who was a bit of a crusty journo. And so, of course, all that fun that was in the program went, and you know, Bill didn't do a bad job, but it just wasn't what Melbourne wanted. And 3AW went from number one in the ratings to about number six in about two surveys. And that big change, that big lineup change, was what killed off the station. So hoping that doesn't happen with the big lineup change that we've just announced this week. So at the end of that, and I love telling this story because there's a gentleman in our newsroom who is just the loveliest guy, Dennis O'Kane. You don't know Dennis O'Kane from our newsroom? Fantastic man. He was brought in to replace Mike Peterson because Mike was fired because the station had fallen apart. We had no revenue because everyone had bailed out because we weren't rating, and talk radio is very expensive to run, so we were in the red. We were in the red and things weren't looking too good. So Dennis O'Kane was brought in to replace Mike Peterson. And Dennis decided, "I'm going to take a punt. There's these guys who are on Triple R and they've been doing 3AK Breakfast for a year. I think they're very good." Lawyers, Guns and Money was the name of the show, with Ross Stevenson and Dennis Donahue. And so he put them in Breakfast with Dean Banks. So Ross, Dean and Dennis, he put them in Breakfast. And Neil Mitchell, who had been doing weekends, had been in the mid-80s, had then moved to Drive during that awful period of thinking person's radio. And Dennis said, "I like Neil. I think Neil's got what it takes. I'm going to put him in mornings." So it was Dennis O'Kane who built the building blocks in 1990 that really established 3AW as to how it is today, and the station has been so successful for the best part of 40 years, or 30 years, all based on the decisions made by Dennis O'Kane. The only problem was Dennis's signings were expensive, and again the station was broke, so we were very much in danger of being bankrupted and shut down. So they sacked Dennis O'Kane. And then the guy that they put in charge then was a guy named Tony Bell, whose nickname was Slasher, Tony Slasher Bell. He came in and he said, "I like the changes that Dennis has made, but the station's too expensive. How many staff does each program have?" And they said, "Oh, four or five." And he said, "Right, make it two." It was sack half the staff. "Sales, what do you earn on commissions?" "You know, 10%. Make it five." And he just went through and just cut everything, sacked anyone who he didn't feel was necessary, and that got the station back into the black. So at least the station was now vaguely profitable. And then credit to Tony Bell, as I say, he said that he liked the lineup that Dennis had put in place. And he said, "What 3AW's audience like is stability." And he said, "So I don't care if I tune in and hear you reading the phone book. I want to hear you guys on air talking, not playing music unless there's a real reason to. It's got to be about talking and calls. And if you can do that, we will eventually get back to number one." And in 1993, it actually took 3 years. Neil hit number one, Ross and Dean, as it was then, because Dennis Donahue had gone, they hit number one. Bruce and Phil had been put in for nights, they hit number one. Darren James, Weekend Breakfast, he started in, I think, 92, he hit number one, and the station, bang, was back on top.
They sacked Dennis Donahue.
Yeah, they did, yeah. I've never really found out the full story of why Dennis was sacked, but...
Dennis was called in and he said, "Would you be prepared to do the program with Dean Banks and without Ross Stevenson?" He said, "No, I will not work without Ross Stevenson." So they called Ross in and they said, Jimmy Rabin do the program without Dennis Donoghue? He said, sure. Well, I'm really happy to do that. So that's second episode.
Yeah,
you've got the two of them.
Oh, okay. That would probably explain why Dennis and Ross aren't the closest of friends. Yeah. Well, as Uncle Jeff said, you know, radio is not the greatest business. So that really sort of takes us up to where we are now. I mean, I haven't really talked about the football changes. With, you know, Rex Hunt joining the station was, as our chief football caller, was a remarkable thing. And Rex was a polarising person. You either loved him or loathed him. I had the pleasure of working with him producing his fishing show on a Friday night ahead of Bruce and Phil's show. And the man was a genius, but he was stark raving mad. But I love him to this day. The other change that was a big shake-up was the year that Stan Zemanek did Drive. Stan was in the newspaper every day. The publicity around Stan Zemanek was always amazing. And I've got two quick stories of Stan. He, on the very first day, because I was his panel operator at that stage, because I was producing Ernie Sigley's program in the afternoons, but I'd stick around after Ernie's show and I'd panel for Drive. And on Stan's very first show, he's sat at the desk and he's looked up and he's realised, because we had two control rooms, one there and one there. And so the host seat was sort of facing the door. So 30 seconds before we're about to go to air for Stan's very first show, he turns to the producers and over the intercom says, I don't like the layout of the studio. Can someone get Graham Mott for me, the general manager? Can someone get Graham Mott? I don't like the layout of the studio. I want it changed. And his producers were both on the intercom. Don't worry about that, Stan. Forget that. It's not important. They're not going to change it for you. Just let's just do the show. No. I want somebody to talk to Graham Mott for me. Who's going to talk to Graham Mott for me? And they're, Stan, you're on air in 10 seconds. Don't worry about it. And so I've just hit the button and said, Stan, I'll go see Graham for you at 6 o'clock after the show. And he said, oh, thank you, mate. And later on, he said to me, I just wanted to know if they were on my side or management's side. So Stan was, he liked to, you know, do little tests with people. The other thing that Stan did, I learned a lot from Stan, and I could never hope to replicate what he did. He wasn't a great fit for 3AW because Drive was always news and current affairs. And Stan, I love him to death, but he was politically and news-related stuff. He was a bit of an idiot. There was a protest, and the producers got somebody from the protest. I've no idea what they were protesting about. But Stan got this guy on and started talking to him, and Stan realised that this guy had no idea why he was actually protesting. Stan would ask him a question and he'd just spout some gibberish, and Stan would say, no, but answer my question. And he would ask the question again. And the guy couldn't answer because he had no idea why he was protesting. So Stan continued that interview for 35 minutes without taking an ad break, just asking the same questions over and over. And the producers are going nuts. Stan, you've got to get to a break. You've got to get to a break. We've still got four ad breaks to fit in. And it's now almost quarter to the hour. And we still had four ad breaks to fit in, which is, you know, 12 minutes of ads. So we've done 35 minutes of talk with this idiot on the phone. And we've got all these ads we've got to fit in. It's impossible to do. And Stan wound up the interview, went to an ad break. And standing in the control room with us at that time were the general manager, Graham Mott, the head of sales, Sue Chapman, and a bunch of other executives who had all come around to find out what the hell was going on. And so the producers said to Stan, what the hell, what are we going to do? And Stan said, the whole of Melbourne, like you guys who have all come into the control room, are wondering exactly what the hell I'm doing. He said, I've got everyone's attention. Everybody is listening going, oh my God, I can't believe this. So I've said to him, what are we going to do with all these ads? And Stan then said, as we came out of that ad break, Stan said, now I'm really, really sorry to do this. I'm sorry to you, the audience, and I'm sorry to the clients. The clients pay good money to be advertise on this show, and I've stuffed them around, and I've stuffed you, the audience, around with that interview. But what I want you to do is a favour for me. I want you to pay very close attention to these next ads because these clients have been messed around by me and all I can do is apologise. And if I know that you're going to listen closely, that will help repair the damage that I've caused with these clients. And then we went to the ad break and I, along with everyone, was going, Oh, yeah, yeah. Blair, yeah, Sunraysia, yeah, the fruit juice company, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, that'd be okay. And everyone was listening to the ads. And then we came out of that ad break and he said, now again, we have four ad breaks we've got to get to. We've only done two. I've got to do it again. So again, please pay attention to these ads. And for the next 12 minutes, we were all gripped by these ads. It was so Stan really, he broke all the rules in radio. He was quite a unique broadcaster. But sadly, wrong time slot. Great talent, but wrong time slot. So that sort of brings us up to pretty much now, because we've had a fairly rock solid run since then. A couple of changes with Philip and myself getting sacked after, sadly, Bruce passed away. Phil and I did nights for another couple of years. Then we got sacked and replaced with John Stanley from Sydney. That didn't work, and then management put Dennis in nights so they could make room for DD in afternoons. DD had a couple of years there, but their management told her that she was no longer required at the end of the year, and DD chose to walk then and there, which is very sad. I have great affection for DD, but we've lost a lot of people over the journey that I have great affection for, and sadly, as Uncle Jeff said, that's the industry. But has anyone got any questions? I'm happy to answer anything. I'm not here to be a spokesperson for management, so I'll give you happily
Why
give you.
They didn't put Tony on at 3 o'clock and leave Jackie at 12 to 2, because 12 to 3 is more a women's thing, like they said, and maybe, you know, all the things that Tony does at night time, you can't have an hour with Glenn Manton, you can't have an hour with Doctor, you know, Monday nights, and
yep.
How's he going to get new people or do whatever he's going to do?
I think
it's a bit risque sometimes, it's not going to...
Well, I think the reason they've gone for Tony in afternoons and Jackie in drive is because Jackie is a journalist and Tony's not.
Yeah.
And Tony, I've always been a big believer, the 2 years that I produced Ernie in 2001 and 2002, I wanted to rebrand the show as Laughternoons with Ernie Sigley. And Steve Price said, no, that's going too far. It's a stupid idea. It's not going to happen. But I kept pushing it, but it never actually happened. What I loved about 3AW was that breakfast was a class of its own. It was newsy related, but very funny. It was just a world of its own, the breakfast show. Neil in mornings with the news and current affairs set the agenda for the day and did an excellent job of that. With Ernie in afternoons, it's a very anti-3AW thing to do, but my thing was always, let's avoid news as much as possible. The newsroom have got it covered, so they can keep people up to date. And if there is actually breaking news during our show, of course we'll cover it. But I'm not going to get a politician on to talk about the, you know, trains and that sort of stuff. We're not going to do that with any, we're just going to have fun. And then Drive was Steve Price for a while and before Stan. And then Darren for all those years. That was the other news and current affairs show. So Neil set the agenda. Drive would you know, rehash it at the end of the day and give updates. But afternoons was a break, because when you're having lunch, do you really want to be weighed down by, you know, a rehash of what Neil's just finished covering? Because one of the criticisms we have had over the journey is when Neil covers a topic in the morning, then afternoons covers it, and then Drive covers it. Because there are people who all day, so they're hearing the same story three times, sometimes with the same people being interviewed. So I loved the idea of afternoons being a break from that, and I think that's what Tony does offer. Tony's a funny, odd character, but he is also very capable of doing news and current affairs. He's a touch on the right wing side for my liking, but you know, a bit too far sometimes. But I love him, and he can easily cover news if it happens. But I think having Jackie as a journalist in Drive is, it makes more sense having Tony in afternoons and Jackie in Drive. That's my thoughts anyway. I've got to stop touching that. Any other questions?
People that are working at 3AW these days, who's the longest? Who's been there the longest?
In terms of on air?
Or even off air?
Off air, it would be. Well,
David Mann's been there for a long time.
David Mann started in 1971, I think it was. So yeah, and he's not there in an official role now. He was our promotions and marketing manager for many years, but he's still there doing Man About Town bits and pieces, but sort of like me, is a casual now as opposed to a full-timer. So yeah, David Mann is probably the longest. Our longest serving contributor is Malcolm Stewart on Drive, because he's been there since the early 1970s as well. But Ross Stevenson, 1990. Darren James, sort of on and off, because he was there in the 80s and then went to Double TFM and 3AK with Bruce, but then came back to do Weekend. Dennis has come and gone. He's been in our newsroom for quite a long time this time round. Tony Tardio, David Armstrong. Damien Tardio's in here, yes. Philip Brady was the music man in the 1970s. I love, Phil tells the story of the day they brought him in and said, we've got to let you go as the Weekend music man, Phil. The station has changed direction. You don't sound enough like Darren Hinch. And he says, oh, okay, well, that's terribly sad, but I understand. So Phil left the station and that weekend tuned in to hear who had replaced him, who sounded more like Darren Hinch than Philip Brady did, and it was Jane Holmes.
Can I just ask, the barbecue guy had a stroke last year. What happened to him? Is he still okay but not on radio anymore?
Oh, Bob Hart? Yeah, still with us, but yeah, just sadly not, yeah, not
so not up to it. I hope he's okay, right? Anyway.
He's okay, but yeah, not happy, not willing to do it anymore.
How long is the guy that does the thing with you when he has all the songs on Sunday night?
Kevin Trask?
Kevin Trask, yeah, I mean, I know it's Diane's cousin.
Diana Trask's cousin. Yeah, Kevin joined us in 2001. Kevin joined us on Remember When and has been there ever since, yeah. Paul Harris would be the second longest running one.
Rick Milne.
Rick Milne came with Keith in 1990, but Paul Harris goes back to Drive with Paul Barber in the 1980s. So in terms of contributors, it would be Malcolm Stewart's the longest, Paul Harris the second, Rick Milne the third, I would think. Yeah.
I don't know whether Ernie Sigley interviewed his mother on 3AW, I think in 1965. He said, what do you think about this decimal currency that's coming on? He said, I think it's nonsense and it'll never come to Footscray.
That's wonderful. Yes?
Dennis Walter.
Dennis Walter, yes.
And also was Keith McGowan.
Keith McGowan came in 1990 after his huge career. My favourite—I don't know—we're out of time, but my favourite Keith McGowan story is when there was that big race between Darren Hinch and Bert Newton. I can never remember who was on what station. I think Bert might have been on UZ, and where was Darren? Darren was on 3XY, I think, and Bert was on 3UZ. And Bert was the king of Melbourne radio, and Darren was on 3XY. And then Darren left and he came to 3AW. And he said, I'm going to knock off Bert Newton. And Keith was on 3MP up against them. So the three of them were up against each other. But it was always the race between, Bert was the king, but Darren was slowly getting there. And Darren, the survey that he knew he was going to defeat Bert because the ratings were just heading in that direction, Darren hired a boat on the Yarra to have a massive party to celebrate the fact that Darren was going to knock off Bert Newton. And he did indeed knock off Bert Newton, but Keith McGowan was number one on 3MP or 3AK. I can't remember. But yeah, Keith beat them both. And it was a great story for Keith to tell at parties.